and gentlemen, I would like to welcome you to the East Chicago Public Library in celebration of Black History Month. Before I begin, I would like to all of our board members that are present, I would like to acknowledge you. Please stand. Thank you so much, Ms. Tony Smith. And I would like to recognize any and all dignitaries that are here. If you would please stand. I will continue. I would like to welcome you here. Oh, we have one in the back. How are you? Ms. Benita Arnold. Councilwoman at large. I would like to welcome you here because this is one of those rare occasions that we can celebrate and rejoice our history. Many people have suffered and died to give us the opportunity, or me the opportunity, to be able to stand here before you and welcome you here to the East Chicago Public Library. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Because the Honorable Mayor Anthony Copeland had another engagement, I would like to extend his warmest heartfelt greeting on this occasion. Thank you for sharing with us. We have a play, and I think you will enjoy it. So I'm going to say once again, welcome to the East Chicago Public Library. Anytime, stop by and read a book.
And also reciting the Black National Anthem. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty.
Those that endured hardships so that we could have some of the necessities that we enjoy on today. Lord, we just ask that you bless the rest of this program, that you would be in this place. And God, not only for those that came before us, but we ask that you would strengthen us for the struggles that lie ahead. Give us the strength to help those that are weak. Give us the strength and the ability to lift up the bowed down heads and to continue to press on toward the mark of the high calling, God, that is yet a lot of work that needs to be done, And we ask that you would give us the strength and the fortitude to do that. In Jesus' matchless name we pray and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Cross where my Savior died, down where from cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied, singing glory to his name, singing glory to his name, precious name, singing glory to his name. Oh, there to my heart was the blood applied, singing glory to his name.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The month of February for many Americans may mean a variety of different events. Groundhog Day, which in many minds determines if winter chills will remain with us for 6 more weeks. Valentine's Day, a special day of recognizing one's sweetheart or significant other. Or President's Day, a day of reflection and commemoration of those who held our nation's highest office.
But for African Americans, February is a month of reflection and special recognition of our American history, a 28-day salute to our national and international heroes and sheroes who helped build the mightiest nation the world has ever witnessed.
As members of the most unique group of citizens to ever occupy this nation, this month is also an especially significant time of year for us. It is a time of reflection, introspection, and self-analysis as a people and as a race on how we came to overcome such incredible odds to determine our place in America's great and vast history.
Our place in this nation of immigrants and melting pot of over 170 nationalities is the most unique of any other membership group in America's history. We were the only people brought here against our will, culturally debased, enslaved, and legislated against to control and further stagnate their growth and progress. No other group in this nation can ever claim such a harshness or barbaric treatment other than possibly the Native American Indian.
It is at this time of the year we take the time to see who we are, reflect on our past, honor our present, and prepare for the direction of our future. Should we just take the time out of every year for this reflection?
No, every waking moment should be a reflection of where we have come from, where we are now, and how we should look at our future. No one knows where they're going until they know where they have been. And this evening, we hope that in this brief program, we will see the significance of our past, our strive towards freedom and dignity in a foreign land, the fight for equality and full citizenship in a, for a piece of the elusive American dream.
This afternoon, this evening, we plan to do just that, reflect on our past, respect our present, and refine our future.
It would be mere folly for us this afternoon to say that we could sum up the contributions of African Americans to our nation in a mere once-a-year 28-day celebration. Therefore, it is not even remotely possible for us to take on this Herculean task in a 90-minute play exercise. What we want to accomplish this evening is to take you on a journey of history through song and characterizations of the events and the people that created the whirling winds of change that transformed a nation. When its first slave came ashore in 1619, forced to labor, sweat under barbaric conditions, suffer suffered the legal shackles of non-citizenship and subhuman status by his then slave master, to ascend to be the ruler over his slave master's descendants, who elect his descendant to their highest and most powerful administrative office in the world, the President of the United States. Truly, this is a remarkable story of perseverance, struggle, faith, and prayer, and proof beyond human understanding that God is still in control. Our story can only begin at the beginning on the shores of Virginia in 1619.
The first African slaves were brought to the shores of Jamestown, Virginia in 1619 and were treated as the European indentured servant. They could work for a few years and buy only their freedom, after which they could buy land, vote, and serve in judicial functions. However, after a few decades of this, the need for cheap labor became more and more intense, especially in the tobacco and rice fields of the South. By the 1660s, the labor of the slave, African slave, became essential to the health of the Southern colonial economy. Slave labor became a hot commodity. Thousands of men, women, and children of West African descent were herded into the bowels of slave ships for the hellish three-month journey known as the Middle Passage. With limited food, suffocating conditions, and no more than a half foot separating the kidnapped passengers, 1 in 6 Africans made it through the horrific nightmare, succumbing to a variety of diseases from dysentery to cholera. By 1801, over 1 million slaves had survived this perilous voyage. However, tragically, millions drowned and perished under the subhuman conditions of the ship. A survivor of the incredible journey wrote a narrative in his own voice that inflamed and strengthened the abolitionist movement in the United States. His name was Alida Ikiano, a native of eastern Nigeria.
I was kidnapped. I was kidnapped from my own native land. What I can remember, I remember being chained to hundreds of women and men and young children. I was only 12 years old. They took my freedom away from me. I remember I opened my eyes and I saw this big vessel. In this vessel, before I was allowed to get on the vessel, they pounded my bodies. They beat me and made me feel terrible. And then as I got into the vessel, I went into this dark room. And inside this black room, all I heard was a lot of screaming, yelling, and crying. I can remember that smell. The smell was so bad that I almost suffocated. And before I could catch my sanity, I was chained down to the bottom ship. And there, I can remember seeing people throw themselves over. And they said their brother just died into being enslaved. My skin was ripped and blood was torn from my skin.
Mr. Ikiano arrived in the New World 3 months later and was sold to a Virginia business owner, who promptly told him he had to change his name to Gustavo Vassa and learn the King's English. When he refused, Ikiano was beaten until he submitted to his new subservient lifestyle. Ikiano, now known as Gustavo Vassa, toiled for his master for 5 years until he was sold to an English gentleman in Boston who was immediately impressed with his intelligence of a now teenage slave. He offered him a job to buy his freedom, and within 2 years, Vassal was a freed man. He never forgot his heroic Middle Passage and his slave years. In 1768, he wrote and published his experiences in a journal entitled An Interesting Narrative of the Life of Udala Ikiano, or Gustava Vassa, in the Boston Abolitionist Press. It created the fuel the abolitionist cause needed to create a firestorm of anti-slavery sentiment in the New England area.
From the time the African and America became a part of our nation's early beginnings as slaves, with it came protest and rebellion. Most came in the form of simple resistance to armed struggle and even suicide by leaping over the side of the slave ships during the Middle Passage. Though once established on land, the slave craved his freedom and sought any means to obtain it, some by buying it from their masters or by fleeing the plantation through the Underground Railroad. However, by whatever means he did it, the Africans in America desired to be free from the first time he or she set foot on this strange land. But what would happen to him after he obtained it? Did he try to return to his native African land or try to assimilate in this new hostile land that he was never asked to be brought to? Many tried the latter to make the best of their newly found freedom. And though they were restricted in their travels for fear of being kidnapped or returned to slavery, many thought the only way was to adapt to this strange new country. The newly freed slaves still had to deal with mistreatment of racism and unfair treatment even while in the North, and yet he refused to take it lying down.
Richard Allen was born a slave in 1760 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and grew up in a plantation in Delaware. He later brought his freedom and moved back to Philadelphia and formed the Free African Church Society in 1787. He joined the Methodist Church in Philadelphia and soon became an ordained minister under the faith while attending a segregated St. George Methodist Church in Philadelphia. Allen was a powerful charismatic orator, and his small congregation of free men and women grew rapidly at St. George. Allen was content to remain at St. George, even if his congregation was regulated only to the balcony. Allen was quietly incensed by this, but never spoke out against it until one day an insult man had stand up and altered the course of a freed man and women of color in America forever.
Good evening, sirs and ma'ams. My name is Richard Allen, and today is the beginning of the end for my people, the end of indignation, the end of abuse, the end of indignity. How did this happen? One morning, one Sunday morning in 1787, we were worshiping at St. George Methodist Church. We had come down from the balcony to pray at the altar, as we've always done, when a white deacon came to one of my congregational members, and he asked him to get up. White people do not want to pray with you. And I asked the deacon in my normal tone, sir, please allow us to at least finish our prayer. He said no, and he was most insistent, to the point of physically trying to remove my congregant from his knees. Well, that was enough for me. After all, we have to, as freed men and women, former slaves, we have to deal with enough indignity out in the streets of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And then we have to come into the house of the Lord and deal with the same thing? No, no. I told my congregation up, we'll never darken this door again. And with the few pennies we had, we got together. And we would decide if we had to lay out in the field, at least it was more dignified than laying in the same place that didn't want us. Having our own place to worship God in dignity and respect was my top priority. So in 1794, with the money we saved, we opened up a blacksmith shop. It wasn't much to look at, true enough. But we were freer there than any time we set foot in St. George Methodist Episcopal Church. I knew then that it had to be more than just a church that we established. We had to do something to help our people, to elevate our people to a new level. And that meant education, training, able to give them jobs and create jobs for our people. So I began an educational process. We opened up over 20 schools for our people during this period. But more importantly, I knew there were other freed men and women who were just like me, who wanted to worship God and dignity and respect. So I united them all. And in 1816, with now over 300 members of my new church, we named it First African Methodist Episcopal Church. And I became its first bishop. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Richard Allen.
Bishop Allen also used his AME churches to fund the Underground Railroad in the South and worked closely with the Quakers to help over 200 slaves to freedom in the North and to Canada. To this very day, those established towns in Canada by ex-slaves that Allen helped to freedom are still in existence in Quebec, Canada, Ontario. As founder and newly elected bishop, Allen was also better than his word about First AME Church. African Methodism grew not only in the United States, but spread its tentacles all over the world, with over 3,000 churches worldwide, 30 colleges and universities. It still maintains the oldest university for Black Americans in the states, Wilberforce University in Ohio, named after one of the most pronounced abolitionist protesters of slavery in the British Empire, William Wilberforce.
Protest was not always the tools of Black males. Many women of color also risked their lives for the cause of freedom and their opposition to slavery, but none were as colorful, braver, or more determined as Harriet Tubman, called appropriately the Moses of her people.
Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land, tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. Way down in Egypt land, tell old Pharaoh, let my people go.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am Harriet Tubman, escaped slave. I ran away from my master's plantation in the fall of 1849, leaving my mother, my father, and my brothers and sisters. But I returned to the South 19 times to free hundreds of slaves, including my entire family. I took this perilous journey with bloodhounds on my trail and bounties over my head that went as high as $20,000 for my capture, dead or alive. On top of that, I suffered from sleeping spells caused by a head injury while a slave. I was sometimes, at any uncontrollable moment, going to a trance-like state. But undaunted, returned to the South time after time, with only the North Star as my guide and a six-shooter on my side for protection. I never lost a passenger on my Underground Railroad. I freed over 300 people over a five-year span, and afterwards became a Union spy, nurse, and a commander over 300 free Black soldiers that led a gun raid in the Civil War, freeing another 800 people without losing a single Union soldier. President Lincoln cited me personally for my military accomplishments and said he was astonished by the number of slaves I brought to freedom. I simply responded by saying, I could have saved a lot more if I could have convinced them that they were slaves.
Perhaps the powerful orator and protester of slavery of his time, the most powerful orator and protester of slavery of his time, black or white, was an ex-runaway slave named Frederick Douglass. Douglass, an author, statesman, and reformer, was born a slave in 1818. At the age of 12, his master's wife started teaching him how to read. As Douglass progressed academically, he began to read newspapers, books, and political papers. This exposed him to a wealth of knowledge and led him to first question slavery and then condemn the institution of slavery. In 1838, Douglass escaped from his plantation and became a fiery leader of the abolitionist movement, gaining attention from his dazzling oratory skills and penetrating anti-slavery writings. Many Northerners found it hard to believe that this man of such brilliance could have ever been a slave. On July 5, 1852, at the Corinthian Hall in Rochester, New York, Douglass was asked to be the keynote speaker by the Ladies of Rochester Anti-Slavery Sewing Society to commemorate the 76th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Frederick Douglass's famous 4th of July speech is arguably one of the greatest oratories in American history and was one of the key components in initiating the end of slavery. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let us return to that fateful day to hear one of our greatest leaders of the 19th century, Frederick Douglass.
Thank you. Mr. President, friends and fellow citizens, he who could address this audience without a quailing sensation has stronger nerves than I do. I do not remember ever to have spirit as a speaker before such an assembly was shrinking, nor with greater distrust of my abilities than I do today. Should I seem at ease, my appearance with much misrepresents me. Fellow citizens, pardon me. Allow me to ask, why am I called upon to speak here today? What have I? Or those I represent to do with your national independence? Do you mean to mock me by asking me to speak here today? I shall see this day and its popular characteristics from the slave's point of view. What to the American slave is your 4th of July? Well, I answer, a day that reveals to him more than any other days in all the year, the gross injustice and cruelty to which he is constant victim to. To him, your celebration is a sham, your boasted liberty an unholy license, your national greatness a swelling vanity, your sounds of rejoicing, shouts of liberty and equality, a holy mockery, empty and heartless. Your denunciation of tyrants are brass fronted impudence. Your prayers and hymns, your sermons of thanksgiving, with all your religious parade and solemnity, are to him mere bombast, fraud, deception and hypocrisy, a thin veil to cover up crimes which would disgrace even a savage nation. There is not a nation on earth or practices more shocking and bloody than those of the people of the United States at this very hour. Go where you may, search where you will, roam through all the monarchies and despotisms of the old world. Travel through South America. Search out every abuse. And when you have found the last, lay your facts by the sides of the everyday practices of this nation. And you will say with me that for revolting barbarity and shameless hypocrisy, America reigns without a rival.
The Douglas had no fear when it came to eloquent oratory. There was a female counterpart who could captivate an audience with her sheer power and passion, a woman with fire in her belly. When it came to the rights of women and the suffrage of her people, her name, Sojourner Truth. Born a slave in 1797 in Schuylkill, Ulster County, New York, under the name Isabella Bumfrey, she escaped with her infant daughter to freedom in 1826. She later returned and went to court to recover her son, whom she had left behind. Her lawsuit was then the first time a black woman sued a white man and won in a case involving slavery in the North. In 1843, she received a vision from God telling her to change her name to Sojourner Truth. From that point on, she traveled and preached about the evils of slavery and became extremely popular with more prominent abolitionists at the time. Known for her fiery oratory and cutting-edge comments, Truth was best known for her most famous speech, "Ain't I a Woman?" delivered at the Akron, Ohio Women's Rights Convention in 1851. Without any further ado, let's hear that famous rendition that it was presented 161 years ago.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child, a long ways from home, a long way from.
Gentlemen, I recollect once when the missus of the house, she tells me to sweep the kitchen floor. Well, once I was sweeping the kitchen floor, I finds a biscuit. I was so hungry, I had to bend down and pick the biscuit up and eat it. I just didn't care when the missus came in, because she said, "What's that there you doing?" And I said, "Sweeping the kitchen floor," like she tells me to. "Just sweeping the kitchen floor." And she said, "What's that there you eating?" I said, "Oh, nothing but a biscuit. Nothing but a biscuit I finds on the floor. Nothing but a biscuit." All of a sudden, she grabbed that broom and she started hitting me with it. She hit me all in my back. She hit me in my head. And she beat me till I could be beaten no more. Then she got some salt and she rubbed it into the cuts to make the pain worse. Lord, my God, those were the awful days. Now, that white man over there says his women got to be helped into carriages, over ditches, and have the best place everywhere. Well, I ain't been helped into nobody's carriage, over nobody's ditch, and had the best place nowhere. Ain't I as a woman? He said they can't scrub floors because their fingernails may crack or the horns may get too rough. Well, I done scrubbed more floors than you put together in years. Ain't I as a woman? Just in case you don't know, I'm a black, proud, beautiful woman, and I better start getting treated like one.
As Africans in America became more educated and savvy in their thinking, Many sought to remedy their situation by legal means. One of those who did so was a slave named Dred Scott. Although he was owned by a Northern Army doctor, he was taught how to read and became a very learned man. He decided to challenge the rule of law and the core of this peculiar institution known as slavery before the highest court in the land, the United States Supreme Court.
I, Roger B. Taney, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, will deliver the majority opinion, which has been decided by a 72 vote in the case of Dred Scott versus John Sanford. And it reads, any person descended from slaves rather than he or she freed or slave is not considered a citizen of the United States and therefore is not protected under the Bill of Rights. The African has no claim to freedom and has no legal standing to bring a suit in a federal court. Therefore, in conclusion, Dred Scott is considered private property of his master and has no rights that a white man is bound to respect. So says our ruling on this day, March 6, 1857.
The decision further inflamed the abolitionist movement and nudged the county closer to an eventual civil war. However, ironically, the Scott decision became the groundwork for the legally worded construction of Abraham Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation and the 13th Amendment, which abolished slavery in 1863. Ironically, Dred Scott was emancipated by his new masters some 3 months after the Supreme Court decision. Sadly, Scott lived less than 18 months as a free man, dying from tuberculosis in 1858. However, through his legal fight in court, his family and beloved wife Harriet and thousands of others did enjoy the freedom her husband set the legal groundwork for 6 years later. Once the Civil War ended, there was a whirlwind of progress for Africans in America. Reconstruction gave blacks the right to vote for the first time in the South, and with the new legislative legal rights, coupled with citizenship, granted blacks in 1875 the right to patent their inventions. Some of the most creative inventors and entrepreneurs came out of this period. These inventors and scientists helped to fuel the great industrial revolution during this 30-year period. Many of the items invented and patented are still in use today. Let's meet some of them.
Good evening. My name is Elijah McCoy of the Real McCoy family. I had a total of 67 inventions for the lubrication of the train motor steam engine. This allowed the train to go for hundreds of miles before stopping. My invention did more than industrialize the West than any other invention in the 19th century.
Good evening, my name is Sarah Bull. I had invented one of the most overlooked of all household items. I had invented the ironing board in 1890.
Good evening, my name is Granville T. Woods, the inventor for more than 20 patents for electric industrial appliances. My more popular inventions were the telegraph, the incubator, the steam boiler furnace, and the mechanical braking. General Electric companies call me the greatest inventor in the world.
Hello, my name is George Washington Carver. I use 500 ways to make peanuts.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Patricia Bath, ophthalmologist, inventor, academic, and groundbreaker for African-American women. I was the first African-American female doctor to receive a patent for a medical purpose. I conceived and developed the laser probe, a medical device for ablating and removing cataract lenses in 1986. My device painlessly dissolves the cataract with the laser and cleanses the eye and is now used internationally to restore vision to those who have not seen for decades. They're saying that if you can read this, thank the teacher. Well, if you can see me, thank Howard University Med School graduate, Dr. Patricia Bath.
Good afternoon. My name is John Stanton. I designed and built the first refrigerator in Newark, New Jersey in 1890. So when you desire anything cool, or to drink or eat, you can thank me.
The new beginning. Which way for the African American in the 20th century with newly found freedom comes new ingenuity for the now free slave and his ancestors? The Supreme Court, once again, intervenes to define freedom for the newly unshackled black family with Plessy versus Ferguson decision in 1895. And the Jim Crow era begins.
Although Africans in America were made citizens by the 14th Amendment of the Constitution, 1868, they only enjoyed full citizenship rights for a very brief time. The white backlash of the Southern strategy was in full effect by the mid-1890s, and every gain politically and socially by Africans in America were reversed or struck down. Most importantly, the Supreme Court once again intervened and ruled in the Plessy versus Ferguson argument that segregation was justified and separate but equal accommodations would be the norm of the new Southern society in 1895. With the stroke of a legal pen, the Jim Crow era began. Once again, the leadership of African Americans was called into play. At the turn of the century, there stood out a charismatic leader who was once a slave and now had won the favor of the Southern white society. With his gradualism approach, acceptance of white supremacy and social segregation, in an 1895 Atlanta speech given in front of some of the most prominent Southern aristocrats of this time, Booker T. Washington called for blacks to cast down their buckets where they were and not be so concerned about voting rights, social injustice, and equal opportunity. He felt that if blacks proved their worth to whites by providing them with cheap labor, coupled with responsible behavior, whites would become then there in their society.
On the other hand, was an upstart northern-born intellectual named W.E.B. Du Bois, Harvard-educated, world-renowned professor and lecturer who found the philosophy completely devoid of progress for his people. He felt blacks should fight for what was rightfully theirs, become more educated, and be led by the talented 10% of the intellectual class of the black race. These two naturally clashed in many fronts, but one day in 1905, both men decided to put aside their differences and sit down and discuss what was the best direction for black America at the home of Booker T. Washington on the campus of Hampton Institute in Hampton, Virginia. Today, you have the opportunity to listen in on what might have been discussed that day.
I do not understand your contempt for me. All I want is what is good for my people.
But what you want is acceptance of second and third class citizenship, limited opportunities, and segregation.
Not necessarily. If we as Negroes can gain an economic foothold in the South by being content with the status that we have, and by accepting the work as farmers, skilled artisans, domestic workers, and manual laborers, then we can prove our usefulness to the white man. And I think they will gradually accept us into their society.
Sir, in all due respect, I know you were born into slavery, but there's no reason for you to stay a slave mentally. We as a people should ask for the same dignity, the same rights that every race that has come to this shore has demanded. That's the right to vote, for opportunity, for full class citizenship, and a right to determine our own destiny.
I think that is a noble cause, but presently our people are only thought of as ignorant ex-slaves who are chicken thieves and liars. This image must change if we ever expect to be accepted into white society. Enforcing too many issues at a time only leads to more resistance and violence.
Sir, what do you expect us to do? Go back to Africa, accept segregation, or just lay down and die?
Neither. But cast down your bucket where you are and build up your race with hard work and gradualism. Then whites will see your value and begin to accept you.
Sir, I already have value. I have a degree from Fisk University, and I have a doctorate and a PhD from Harvard University in economics and finance. So I already have value. While you were sitting here apologizing for the racist conditions of this country, I was lecturing all over the world.
You're not apologizing, just being realistic. Those degrees are fine, but where do you go for employment? There's only a few positions that will accept a Negro teacher or professor. What I would suggest is, in our schools, that we turn out fewer job seekers and more job makers. Anyone can seek a job, but it takes one's ability to create a job.
My friend, the idea of developing a black entrepreneurial system run by our own people is indeed an admirable cause, and I agree with that. But it's too narrow in its scope and its focus. This great stride of yours for white acceptance, it can only devalue our stride for full citizenship rights. When you create a sense of hopelessness and non-aggression, this again creates a permanent sense of inferiority among our people and complete hopelessness.
Although both men were diametrically opposed to each other philosophically, both contributed mightily to the cause of civil, educational, and the ending of social injustice for African Americans. Booker T. Washington founded Tuskegee Institute and hired renowned scientist George Washington Carver to head his biology department, where his greatest discovery of over 500 uses for the peanut helped revolutionize the farming industry of the South. He further financed with Andrew Carnegie's money organizations that directly opposed segregation and supported an equal education and voting rights for all citizens. W.E.B. Du Bois, though frustrated with the path of gradualism, went on to be the co-founder of the most important civil rights organization of the 20th century, the NAACP, in 1909. He wanted the NAACP to take the legal fight for rights of African Americans to the Supreme Court. He helped hire a team of newly barred lawyers who graduated at the top of their class from Howard University. One particular lawyer stood out among the others he felt should lead the legal team, and his name was Thurgood Marshall. Up to this point in our history, African Americans have participated in every war that this country has fought in. It even was the first to die in service of the cause of freedom. From Crispus Attucks in the Revolutionary War to the heroic Dory Miller, the first African American to win the Silver Star in the early stages of World War II. But it was the Second World War that we were officially recognized for our bravery and heroism. The Tuskegee Airmen, the Red Ball Express, the Sea Ducks, all played a huge part in the successful conclusion of the European-based world conflict. But what was on the mind of the black soldier was, would it make a difference when I return home to America?
I represent all of the African-American soldiers who have fought in every war, conflict, at home or abroad. From Crispus Attucks, a young ex-slave who was the first to die in the American Revolution. We have served admirably, repelling the British rule in the War of 1812. We have fought bravely in the Civil War in every capacity, helping to turn the tides of the war in favor of the Union forces. However, it wasn't until the Second World War that things began to change for the African American soldier. With the first hero, Dory Miller of the war,
a cook. He manned a machine gun, and he brought down two Japanese fighter planes. This proved to a doubting nation that we would not wilt in the face of an attack, and we would fight bravely for a nation that never gave us the proper training or the recognition. Whether the gallantry of the Red Ball Express, a black trucking line that provided ammunition and supplies to the troops during the most furious battles of the war, or to the bravery of the Tuskegee Airmen who risked their lives protecting the bomb squads during the daylight raids over Germany. We knew our time had come. We knew in this war, with the newly acquired media, the newsreel, the magazines, the television, it would show how this nation regarded us. This was our hope. This was our chance to have our story told.
If what I told you was correct, the war would be different. Buoyed by pressure worldwide, America came to realize some of the wrongs she had committed against its most loyal citizens. The first act came in 1948 with the integration of the armed services, signed into law by the insistence of President Harry S. Truman, ironically a former member of the Ku Klux Klan. This made the Korean War conflict in 1951 the first war where black and white soldiers fought side by side. But the next legal decision was even more devastating to the flailing era of Jim Crow. In 1954, that witty attorney, you know the one, that W.E.B. Du Bois hired for the NAACP nearly 20 years ago, argued and won one of the most monumental decisions for civil rights up to that point in the 20th century. Thurgood Marshall took on the case of Brown versus Board of Education before the Supreme Court and fought successfully to end segregation in all public schools. With all deliberate speed was the credo that sent shockwaves through the South, and with it came an inflammatory white backlash of violent resistance and murder. The very idea of a black male youngster sitting next to a white girl in the same school or classroom incensed the racist elements of the South to no end. When the decision was handed down during the fall of 1954, racist groups like the Klan vowed to fight the law with every means possible, legal or illegal. Many schools in the South closed their doors rather than integrate, and private white-only schools permanently dotted the landscape in huge numbers. But the growing hatred would rear its head in other ways, even to the unsuspected travelers from the north.
In August of 1955, Chicago native Emmett T. Till had just graduated from the junior high school when his mother put him on a train to visit his great uncle's farm in Money, Mississippi. The 14-year-old was sheltered from the hatred and racial abuse of the South and had lived most of his life in the north. He had no idea of the simmering fury that could be unleashed against him simply violating the sanctity of a white woman in Mississippi. 2 days into his visit, he was accused of wolf whistling at a white woman who waited on him in the local grocery store. The word spread like wildfire across the tiny backwoods town not far from Greenwood about some nigger from the north who talked dirty to Carolyn Bryant in town. That insult was enough for the husband of Roy Bryant and his half-brother to break in the home of young Till's uncle, who's Moses Wright, and kidnapped him in the middle of the night. Till was brutalized for hours before being shot in the head and his nude body dumped into the Tallahatchie River for a 60-pound cotton gin tied to his neck. Though arrested 2 days later, both men were exonerated by an all-white jury and even bragged about what they did to him and sold the story to Look magazine, saying that nigga got what was coming to him. The crime shocked all of America and put an international spotlight on race relations in the United States. But for Black Americans all over the nation, it became a rallying cry for justice, for change, for retribution. Little did anyone know that change was in the air and in the neighboring state of Alabama only a mere 3 months after the Till lynching.
I was born by the river in a little tent, and oh, just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change will come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living when I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change will come. Oh, yes, it will.
My name is Rosa Parks, and I just returned from another day as a local seamstress. When I boarded the 25th Street Avenue bus for home. While sitting, a white man came to me and told me to go to the back because there were no more seats in the white section. I was tired, not physically tired, mentally tired. Tired of abuse, humiliation, and racism. I've been thinking about young Emmett Till, how he was kidnapped from his uncle's home and then later murdered. And his known killers let go. All of a sudden, all of the acts of racism, humiliation, and hatred came to the surface. And I looked at that white man, and I pointed to him, and I said, no, I am not going anywhere. You know that white man was living. He called for the bus, and the bus driver promptly stopped the bus and called the police and had me arrested. I sat in that jail cell for 4 hours, and I felt freer there than riding any bus in Montgomery.
After the Till case, Black Americans took on racism head on with the successful Montgomery bus boycott. They used their economic clout by walking with dignity for 381 days instead of riding in shame, and brought the city of Montgomery to its knees when the Supreme Court ordered that segregated public transportation was illegal and unconstitutional in December of 1956. More importantly, from it emerged the most recognized and powerful leader of the civil rights movement, a 26-year-old minister named Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Unlike what happened in Mississippi, Dr. King had defeated the racists in Alabama without firing a shot or reacting in any sort of hatred-laced retaliation. Even when his home was bombed at the peak of the boycott, he sought and preached nonviolence as a way of handling the racist mores of the Southern culture by using the moral tenets of Jesus Christ and Mahatma Gandhi. Many thought this was foolish and suicidal to rely on the moral conscience of the Southerner to change his ways, and that the only way to defeat racism and discrimination was with direct, violent confrontation, force against force, fist against fist, and a death for a death. But Dr. King stayed fast with his faith, never yielding to the ugliness of violence, even though his life was often threatened. On the direct opposite of the spectrum emerged another leader of the civil rights movement, a charismatic, ex-drug addict, pimp, and hustler, who had reformed himself with the help of the Nation of Islam. Malcolm X was the polar opposite of Dr. King. He believed in a head for a head, self-defense, and violence against those who attacked our people during the stride towards freedom. History tells us that these two gentlemen only met once, and now you will hear out of their own mouths what may have transpired when they finally did meet that fateful afternoon in Washington, D.C.
I met Malcolm for a few minutes when I was in Washington, D.C., and I was very impressed with him. He's very articulate, and though we only spoke for a few minutes, I liked him. But I totally disagree with his philosophical and social positions on violence. And I think he's done our people a great disservice by telling Negroes to go and arm themselves against the struggle. You see, I believe that nonviolence is the crucial answer to all our social ills of today.
Concerning nonviolence, nonviolence is fine as long as it works, but it is criminal to teach a man not to defend himself when he is the constant victim of brutal attacks. If violence is wrong in America, then violence is wrong abroad. If it is wrong to be violent defending black women and black children and black babies and black men, then it is wrong for America to draft us and make us violent abroad in her defense. And if it is right for America to draft us and teach us to be violent in her defense, then it is right for you and me to do whatever is necessary to defend our own people right here in this country.
The ultimate weakness of violence is that it's a descending spiral, beginning the very thing it seeks to destroy. Now, you may murder the hater, but you don't murder the hate. And it has no truth to it, no balance. Now, as far as America is concerned, their very goal is freedom. And that is the same goal as our people. And no matter how abused and scorned that we are, our destiny is tied up with America.
Dr. King wants the same thing I want. Freedom. When a person puts the right perspective on freedom, there is nothing under the sun that they will not do to obtain that freedom. But when a man tells you he wants freedom, and in the next breath he's going to tell you what he won't do or what he doesn't believe in doing to obtain that freedom, he doesn't believe in freedom. A man who believes in freedom will do anything under the sun to obtain or preserve that freedom. And if you're not willing to die for it, then put the word freedom out of your vocabulary.
At the center of Christian faith is the affirmation that God is in the universe and on the ground and the essence of all reality. God has placed within the very structure of the universe a certain moral principle that is fixed and immutable. God is love. He who hates does not know God, but love has the key that unlocks the door to a man's soul. Now, I've consistently preached about nonviolence, and I support it with all my soul and with all my heart, because we've gotten to the point in this country where it's not a matter of debating violence and nonviolence, but it's nonviolence or non-existence.
I believe in a religion that believes in freedom. There's nothing in our book, the Quran, that teaches us to suffer peacefully. Our religion teaches us to be intelligent, be peaceful, be courteous, obey the law, respect everyone. But if somebody puts their hands on you, send them to the cemetery. Now that's a good religion.
The philosophy of hate just leaves me cold and empty. Perhaps because I've been around it all my life and I know what it does to people. The hater never has any remorse, moral compass, or even a conscience. Hate never produced love. It only produces more hate. Now, love can change a man's soul, and it can change his spiritual direction. And this is the faith I go back to the South with. And to the people that oppress us, the racists in Alabama and Mississippi, I tell them, do with us what you will. Burn and bomb our homes, sick police dogs on us, unarmed men, women, and children. Break into our homes in the middle of the night, kidnap our children, and murder them. And we will endure your suffering with our ability to inflict, take, and deal with the suffering. And history will say to us, there was a people who were persecuted for righteousness' sake. And our victory will be more complete because we will disarm you with our power to love.
Murdered in February of 1965 by the very people he thought would lead Black America to economic and political salvation. Towards the end of his life, he realized that violence was not the total answer for America's ills, and that through the legal maneuvering of the courts is where our true answers for freedom would lay. The growing cry for full citizenship rights became the ballad of the civil rights theme during the 60s, and the quest for full voting rights was directly interfaced with these protests. Racist groups in the South turned up the heat for any Black person daring to register with violent attacks, burnings, beatings, jobless, and even murder. During this period of uncertainty and injustice, one woman with humble beginnings, a daughter of a sharecropper and Mississippi native, became the face of the beleaguered African Americans' long-awaited quest for the right to vote. Fannie Lou Hamer came out of nowhere to national and international prominence in her stirring and heartbreaking story at the 1964 Democratic National Convention in Atlantic City. When word got out that her story would be broadcast to an international audience, President Lyndon Johnson, the party's nominee for president, wanted the telecast stopped for fear of the Southern political backlash. But despite the president's bequest, Klan, burning, and bombing threats, this proud Black woman of meager means came to the podium, sat down, and addressed the world of the state of the American South when it came to the voting rights of its African American citizens.
I couldn't hear nobody pray. I couldn't hear nobody pray. Way down yonder, by myself, and I couldn't hear nobody pray. No, I couldn't hear nobody pray. I couldn't hear nobody pray. Way down yonder, by myself, and I couldn't hear nobody pray.
Mr. Chairman and Credentials Committees, my name is Fannie Lou Hamer. I live at 626 East Lafayette Street in Ruleville, Mississippi, Sunflower County. home of Senator James O. Eastland and Senator John Stennis. On the 31st day of August, 18 of us traveled 26 miles to the county courthouse in Indianola to try and register to vote so that we could become first-class citizens. When we arrived, the police chief met us. He stopped our bus and he told us to get off. He said that our bus was the wrong color and he charged the bus driver and each one of us a fine. We were escorted back to Ruleville after our fine was paid. When I arrived home, my children told me that the plantation owner with whom I had sharecropped for 18 years said he was angry because I had tried to register and vote. I told him I didn't register for him, but for myself. That evening, night riders fired 16 bullets into my home, and two girls in Ruleville were shot to send a message to all those who would not give up on registering to vote. I had to leave my home that night for my own safety. On the 6th day of June, I attended a voters registration workshop, and as our bus returned to Mississippi, we were pulled aside by the state police. They told us to get off, and they put us under arrest. I was carried to the county jail, booked, and placed in a cell with Miss Ivita Simpson. The sheriff and a deputy came and took her out, and within minutes, I began to hear screams and boots kicking against flesh. I heard her cry out. I heard her cry out. And I heard her scream. And I heard the police chief call her horrible names. I heard her between screams say, "Lord, have mercy on these men's souls." Then three men came into my cell and they said to me, "Nigger, you're gonna wish you had never been born." They brought in a Negro slave and he beat me with a blackjack until he was exhausted. Then they brought in another Negro and he began to beat me. And then this white man who had been watching, he came over and he began to beat me across the head until I passed out. That night, Mega Evers was murdered, and it was only by the grace of God that I wasn't. All of this on account of us wanting to register to vote so that we could become first-class citizens. And if the Freedom Democratic Party is not seated, then I question America and what she really stands for. Is this the home of the brave and the land of the free? Then why do we have to be arrested, beaten, humiliated, shot at, and murdered because we want to be treated as decent human beings and enjoy the same rights we should have been born with? Thank you, sir.
This powerful testimony by Fannie Lou Hamer electrified the nation and galvanized the black and progressive white voting bloc. In the summer of 1964, there were no black mayors, senators, and governors, and Congress had only 6 representatives of color. Congress had been working on drafting a voting rights bill for years to enforce the rights of black Americans against Southern resistance. However, it remained tabled in committee and languished there because of a lack of political pressure. Now the pressure was back on in the buckets due to the courage of Fannie Lou Hamer and President Johnson himself, moved by the testimonial, turned on all the ample political muscle to get the bill passed and in May of 1965, it was.
Once the fear and intimidation was over and the president ordered federal auditors to protect the rights of black citizens to vote, millions began to register. Some who had never voted before became excited about the prospect of determining who represented them, and for the first time, they felt persons of color could have a real chance of winning. Within months after its passing, Ed Brooke, in 1966, became the first African-American senator from Massachusetts. Then, in 1967, Richard Gordon Hatcher emerged and won the mayorship of Gary, Indiana. It marked the first time a black man was in charge of a major city in the United States. But it didn't stop there. Carl Stokes took over the reins in Cleveland in 1968. Many other African Americans took over the reins of many major cities. Most importantly, in 1973, the South had changed. Once blacks saw what could happen if they voted solidly behind a candidate, the once most rigid southern city in the South, Atlanta, elected its first black mayor in Maynard Jackson. Even in Alabama, whose governor once proclaimed segregation yesterday, segregation now, segregation forever in 1963, elected its first black mayor, Richard Arrington, in a city that many said was once the bastion of segregation, Birmingham, Alabama, in 1979.
And in 2011, East Chicago, Indiana, elected its first black mayor, Mayor Anthony Copeland. As African Americans became more politically savvy, the very idea of now seeking statewide offices such as senators and governors became a realistic goal rather than just a pipe dream as it had been in the brief past. This revelation revealed itself in the face of a little-known black woman with powerful oratory skills and became the focus of the conclusion that there is a real possibility of a person of color winning a statewide or even national political office. Barbara Jordan splashed into the political scene in 1966 by being the first African-American since Reconstruction to win a state Senate seat in the state of Texas. A Texas Southern University graduate, Jordan was known as an expert debater and became the first African-American female to serve as president pro tem of the state Senate and serve for one day as the acting governor of the state of Texas in 1972. In 1972, she was elected to Congress and became the first woman to represent Texas in the House. But it was her appointment to the House Judiciary Committee in 1973 that Jordan was put on a national spotlight. In 1974, the nation was gripped in political agony over the impeachment hearing of then-President Richard Nixon, were impressed by the upstart brilliance of this new member of the House during the television debates. So impressed that the Democratic political forces decided she would be the keynote speaker in the opening bell of the Democratic National Convention in 1976. Jordan was ecstatic about the opportunity that up to that point had only been designated for white males. But more importantly, it was the speech of the ages, and no one was prepared for what this long address did to change forever. Now, African Americans will be regarded on a national political scene. Can we give a round of applause for Barbara Jordan?
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for such a warm reception. Thank you. It was 144 years ago that members of the Democratic Party first met in convention to select a presidential candidate. Since that time, Democrats have continued to convene once every 4 years and draft a party platform and nominate a presidential candidate. And our meeting this week is a continuation of that tradition. But there is something different about tonight. There is something special about tonight. What is different? What is special? I, Barbara Jordan, am a keynote speaker. Now, a lot of years have passed since 1832, and during that time, it would have been most unusual for any national political party to ask a Barbara Jordan to deliver a keynote address. But tonight, here I am, and I feel that notwithstanding the past, that my presence here is one additional bit of evidence that the American dream need not forever be deferred. Now, I began this speech by commenting to you on the uniqueness of a Barbara Jordan making a keynote address. Well, I'm going to close my speech by quoting a Republican president. And I ask you that as you listen to these words of Abraham Lincoln, relate them to the concept of a national community in which every last one of us participates. And I quote, as I would not be a slave, so I would not be a master. This expresses my idea of democracy. Whatever differs from this, to the extent of the difference, is no democracy. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Jordan's speech was almost exactly 12 years to the day of Fannie Lou Hamer's harrowing voting rights saga of horror and terror. But what was significant was that because of the bravery of this sharecropper's daughter to keep the pressure on President Johnson to get the voting rights bill passed, this directly allowed Jordan to be catapulted into this position of national prominence. The nation was now abuzz about seriously considering that maybe African Americans could win a statewide office, or even a national one. The dream of winning a statewide office came in several forms in later years, but none was as ironic and as prophetic as the election of Doug Wilder as the governor of Virginia. Wilder was the direct descendant of slaves brought to Jamestown, Virginia, some 300 years ago. And now had ascended to the state's highest office as the first African American to serve as governor in the southern state since Reconstruction in 1989. In 1989, this was exactly 370 years from the first appearance of Africans on Jamestown, Virginia soil in 1619. Biblically, it says, the people you bring in as slaves, I will make their sons rulers over you. Other dates and timelines have also been significant in our struggle for equality for African Americans. On August 28, 1955, the body of Emmett Till bobs to the surface in the Tallahatchie River in Mississippi, shocking America into a frightening reality of race relations in America. His killers were set free, and it became the rallying point for the civil rights movement. August 28, 1963, Martin Luther King gave his I Have a Dream speech before the largest protest for human rights in the history of the nation. And again, on the most triumphal August 28th of all, Barack Obama, in August 28, 2008, accepts the nomination for the 44th President of the United States, the first African American to ever reach this pinnacle of the power in a nation that once enslaved his father's ancestors. And the most irony of all, exactly 390 years later, from the first time Africans were brought in 1619, the first African American president was sworn in January 2009. We have a great deal of pride because we are remarkable people. No other people have accomplished this on the face in this country, ever. So our story is completely unique. We came here as slaves, debased, our family separated, and completely annihilated. And our culture and everything was legislated against. And yet we overcame in a mere footprint of time, 390 years, to ascend to the highest ranking power in the entire free world. Now we'll have our former cast, and we'll turn this back to Cheryl, and you can introduce our great cast for tonight. Thank you.
Let's give our cast a round of applause. The African-American struggle for freedom, reflecting on our past, respecting our present, and refining our future. I'm going to call the cast to come out. Mr. Demetrius Powers is the production manager and writer of this great play. Let's give him a hand. Next we have Ms. Joyce Martin, who is our assistant production manager. Next we have Ms. Marla Spann, who's another assistant production manager. Next we have Ms. Joanne White. Could you please stand and raise your hand? She's at the door, who's our costume supervisor. Next we have Mr. Calvin Bride, who's our slave man. I believe he had to leave. Next we have Adrian Askew. Next we have Paul Brown, who was Frederick Douglass. Shanita Artis Lindsay, Sojourner Truth. Mr. Charles Moore, who was our soldier. Alexandria Artis, Patricia Bass. Martin Luther artist, John Standard. Alexis Simpson, Sarah Boone. Aaron Woodson, Elijah McCoy. Johnny Alfred III, George Washington Carver. Mr. Orlando Johnson, Booker T. Washington, and Malcolm X. Mary Elizabeth Dawkins, Rosa Parks. Curly Eatman, Fannie Lou Hamer. Ms. Maxine Mungish Cole, Barbara Jordan. Our wonderful psalmist, if she would come out front, is Ms. Mary Ross. Deborah Powers. Our crew members, which is our staff.
Tiana Davis, Ms. Tiffany Berry, Ms. Yvonne Rowe, Ms. Hortensia Gonzalez, Ms. Rosemary Ansons, our playbill design, Mr. Christopher Santana, and our sound design, Mr. Stafford Span Jr. Line up around across the front. Did I miss anybody? I don't think so.
Yourself.
And myself, narrator, Cheryl Smith. Let's give the cast a round of applause. I would like to say this is the first time we've ever done anything like this, but we have gotten the word that they want us to perform this at the Glenn Theater. I do see that our mayor is in the house. Mayor, would you please come? And if there are any other dignitaries, if you can stand, or any other board members, one of our board members, newly board members, I see she's in the back. Our judge is here. I want to thank everyone for coming out and supporting us. We greatly, greatly appreciate it for your time and your patience. We know it might have taken a little time, but our history is very, very important to us, and it's something that we should all know and want to know. So we thank you for your time and your patience. At this point, I'm going to turn the mic over to the judge and to the mayor, and the mayor can give us some closing remarks and possibly a benediction.
I might can say something in closing. I was wrestling with something to say. They said if you can't add to something, surely don't subtract. I've come here today, I'm truly full. You've allowed me to bask in the past. We cannot move forward until we acknowledge the past. They say first, it always takes first. When you look across something, sometimes people look and say, man, it was easy how someone got there to be first. But it usually takes some sense of endurance. It usually takes some sense of sacrifice. But mine pale in comparison to those who were represented on the stage. So I can just tell you that I looked, sitting at my chair, and I looked upon the past of East Chicago with this wall of fame up here, and it took me all the way back because I can remember as a kid looking at some of the trailblazers here on this wall, and then the redemption of the characters here on the stage. But also, when I looked at the program, I was humbled because everything we do in East Chicago is a reflection of us. I tell people God knew where he wanted me to be placed, he put me right in. And I tell people East Chicago is truly a melting pot. What makes a rainbow beautiful is the assortment of colors coming together to portray light in its greatest form. And it don't take much to humble me, you know. But when I see true representation, it shows us the struggle of all of us as a people. And East Chicago is truly the Garden of Eden. In Northwest Indiana, we are the Garden of Eden. That's why God made it so beautiful. And I look with just the board. I don't know if you acknowledge the board. I don't know if all of the board members are here, but I am truly proud to have played a part of putting some of them on the board. But if all the board members were standing here, you would truly just see a reflection and it would just be a beautiful rainbow. And that's what East Chicago is all about. But we could never move forward unless we acknowledge the past. And we, as a people, have gotten here on the backs of others, their struggles, and I acknowledge that today. And I can tell you that as being the chief executive of the city, I was caught up in a meeting, and sometimes you think you can clone yourself and split yourself and be in two places at once. But and I wrestled. I said, man, don't be late. And I said, maybe I shouldn't come. But you know what? That would have been the worst mistake I made. I came here today, and I can tell you that I'm truly blessed to share this event with each and every one of you. So thank you.
Giving praise and thanks to God, it was indeed a pleasure to be here to share with the library in this Black History production. It was amazing, and I'm excited and proud to have been a witness to this type of production in our city. Black history is really important, and I think at this point in time, we've come to a place where in East Chicago, we're represented by an African-American mayor, an African-American clerk, and an African-American judge, which is the first for our city. And I am thankful to God to have the opportunity to share with you. Now, for our benediction, thank you, dear Lord, for this opportunity to share with our city. Father, we know that you have been here in the midst, that you have protected and guided and directed those persons who wanted to put this production together. You've given them wisdom and insight, and we thank you for it. We now ask that you protect us as we depart from this place. Give us traveling grace. Give us your peace of mind and of heart, and we will continue to give you the praise. In your Son, Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.